Hi there. This video is going to talk about protein phosphorylation, how proteins become phosphorylated, and what occurs when they become phosphorylated. So it's going to be a general overview of what phosphorylation is, what it can do to proteins. In this course, we're going to learn very specific instances of kinases and the proteins they phosphorylate, and what that phosphorylation does to proteins. But in this video, we're just talking about, in general, what phosphorylation is and what it can do. What are the possibilities of protein phosphorylation? So what does phosphorylation mean? Well, we have to first start off with an enzyme called a kinase. And in your biochemistry course, you most likely learned about enzymes called kinases. A kinase is a protein that transfers a phosphate group to its substrate. So a kinase is an enzyme, it's going to catalyze a reaction. And so in this instance, we're talking about protein kinases, so they're made of proteins, and they're going to put a phosphate group on their substrate, which is going to be a protein as well. So there are over 500 kinases encoded by the human genome. They play very important roles in regulating all cellular processes, especially cell growth, cell division, and the cell cycle. So let's talk about how a kinase works. So a kinase is an enzyme, and kinases have substrates. And in this instance, the substrate is a protein. So substrates are going to bind to the kinase where? In their active site. So a kinase, again, it's a protein, it's got some three-dimensional structure due to its primary amino acid sequence. It folds into alpha helices and beta sheets and gives it tertiary structure. And in that structure, for a kinase, there's going to be an active site, and that is where the substrate will have high affinity for. So the substrate binds in the active site. So kinases all have an active site. Kinases also have an ATP binding pocket. So it's another domain in the kinase. We talk about domains of proteins. So in this instance here, this domain, that would be the ATP binding domain, and this domain here, that would be the substrate binding domain. So this kinase that I've drawn here has two domains, an active binding site domain, an active site binding site domain, and an ATP binding pocket, or ATP binding domain. So what's gonna bind in the ATP binding pocket? It's gonna be ATP, adenosine triphosphate. And I've drawn my little cartoon there of a adenosine triphosphate. There are three phosphate groups on that molecule. So what's gonna happen here? When a kinase becomes active, and we'll talk in this course that enzymes, all sorts of enzymes, such as kinases, when they're made in the cell, the enzyme could be active, the enzyme could be inactive. So all enzymes can have some level of regulation. So when a kinase is active, so it is functional, it can bind its substrate, and it can bind ATP. So here you go, an active kinase. It binds its substrate, and you can see the substrate binding into the substrate binding domain of the active site, and the ATP binding into the ATP binding pocket. So when this occurs, the kinase will catalyze a reaction. What's that reaction going to be? Well, the kinase will remove one of the phosphate groups, the terminal phosphate group, from ATP and transfer it to the substrate. Now, where is it going to transfer to? It's going to transfer to a hydroxyl group. So when you recall your biochemistry knowledge, you learned that there are 20 amino acids, 20 different amino acids. Three of them have, as one of their functional groups, a hydroxyl group. You should remember which three of those are. If you need to pause this video and look up in your biochem textbook or somewhere the three different functional groups, the three different amino acids that have hydroxyl groups. This is where the phosphate will be transferred. But I'm not going to tell you now, but you should look it up. You should know it from biochemistry. We're going to see these amino acids a lot. So in this substrate, there is a hydroxyl group on some amino acid side chain. And that hydroxyl group will become phosphorylated. So how's that going to occur? Well, the hydrogen is removed, and the oxygen will be attached to the phosphate in the phosphorus in the phosphate group. So the terminal phosphate group from ATP is removed from ATP, and the phosphate group is transferred to the hydroxyl of the substrate. So we're catalyzing a reaction. We're catalyzing the formation of a bond between the phosphate group, specifically the phosphorus, and the hydroxyl oxygen. And so now what have we done to the protein? We have phosphorylated it. So we've just transferred a large, bulky, negatively charged functional group onto the hydroxyl. So we would say now the protein is phosphorylated. Before, the protein was unphosphorylated. The hydroxyl group, it was just the hydroxyl group. So proteins can exist in unphosphorylated versions and phosphorylated versions. What's the phosphorylation going to do to the protein? We'll get to that in the next slide. So this is, in general, how a kinase works. One thing we have to mention here is that we have to remove the phosphate from the ATP. So when this reaction is complete, the ATP is now converted into ADP because we remove the phosphate, transferred it to the substrate. So ADP is released from the ATP binding pocket, where it can go and be recycled to make ATP again. So this reaction will happen over and over. Kinases can perform many phosphorylation events, depending on the catalytic activity of the kinase, or thousands of phosphorylation events per second, depending on the kinase that we're talking about. So in general, this is how a kinase works. All right, so that's a kinase in general. We will learn many kinases in this course and substrates for those kinases. What I want to talk about now is what phosphorylation does to a protein. So here's the kinase from the last slide. It catalyzes this reaction. It phosphorylates the substrate, which is a protein. So there's the unphosphorylated version of the protein and the phosphorylated version of the protein. What does phosphorylation do? And the answer is it depends, right? But the one thing it definitely does is it puts a negative charge on a protein. So the substrate on the left just had a hydroxyl. Substrate on the right, now it's phosphorylated, you have this large negative charge, brand new negative charge, onto this protein. What's that going to do to that substrate, to that protein? Well, phosphorylation can do many different things. So we're going to talk in the next video about the possibilities of phosphorylation, what phosphorylation could do, and I'll give you many examples of what it could do. Throughout the course, we will learn about specific kinases and the specific substrates, and you will learn exactly what phosphorylation does to each individual substrate. But right now, we're just going to talk in generalities of what phosphorylation could do, and you will see that throughout the course. So there are really four things that we're going to talk about phosphorylation affecting in proteins in the cell. So one is going to be protein-protein interactions. Phosphorylating a protein can cause a change in protein-protein interactions. Second thing we'll talk about is localization. Putting this phosphate group on a protein can change where this protein is in the cell. Number three, phosphorylation can regulate the activity of a protein. If a protein is an enzyme, then phosphorylating could change the activity of that enzyme. Number four, phosphorylation can control stability of a protein. And we'll talk about protein stability as well. So this first video just talked about how a kinase functions and the domains of a kinase and the actual reaction of putting a phosphate group on a protein. The next video will talk about these four instances. I will say that when you put this large negatively charged group onto a protein, what that can do, it can do lots of different things to that protein. Now, you know that proteins fold and their structure, their 3D structure, is based upon the amino acids that are present in the protein. Now that you've put a new negative charge on this protein, this can dramatically change the three-dimensional structure of a protein. So just the protein on the left, not phosphorylated, it has some three-dimensional structure. Protein on the right, now it's got this phosphate group on it, it can have a different three-dimensional structure. So changing the structure of a protein can change many things about the proteins. The four things below we will talk about in the next video.